Well, hey, Cathedral, how are you this morning? Excellent, excellent. Well, I'm really glad to be back here. You know, if you've been here the last couple weeks, you know that Pastor Ed and I are kind of back and forth between here and Deerfield Road. But every time I'm not here, my heart is here, and I feel I'm watching this text thread with all the production and worship people, and I'm thinking about you guys and praying about you guys. And even though that's also a part of our church, it really feels really, really good to come home today. So I'm really glad to be here with you guys. We are continuing. Last week we just began on our series called Unsung, Ordinary People, Uncommon Faith. And last week we looked at Hebrews 11, and one of the really cool things that happens at the very end of Hebrews 11 is he said, "And time would fail me to tell you of all of these other great people of faith." He goes through this whole hall of faith, and then gets to the end, is like, I'm out of ink. I don't have the chance to like tell you all these things. But the great thing is, we've got the whole summer. We have the time to study so many of these people in God's word, these people who, many of them, we don't know their names even. They're just normal, regular people like me and like you, but they had great faith in a great Savior. And there's a lot that we can learn from each of these people. So we have intentionally picked some of these people who we don't normally talk about. We're going to talk about Barnabas. We're going to talk about the woman with the issue of blood. We're going to talk about the woman at the well. We're going to talk about possibly the most fun person's name to say, Mephibosheth. You want to say it with me? Mephibosheth. We're going to talk about him a little later. We're going to talk about David's mighty men. People talk about David all the time, but not David's mighty men. We're going to talk about the woman at the well. There's a lot of people that we're going to study in God's word and learn from them about how to have this uncommon, unshakable faith in Jesus Christ. For each one of these, we have tried to think about, like, what is the main piece of faith? What is the main thrust that their story, their account tells us? And today we're going to be talking about relentless faith. The faith that no matter what it takes, I will get to Jesus Christ, whatever it takes. We're going to be in Mark 2. You can flip over in your Bibles there as we do. But our goal this summer is to be stirred up to a greater faith in Jesus Christ. Wherever you're at in your walk with Jesus Christ, if you're just here today, just learning, who is this Jesus person? And what does it really mean to have faith? You're in a great place. And if you've been walking with the Lord for decades, but desire a deeper dependence, a deeper reliance on Jesus Christ for each and every day of your life, a greater security that you feel, a greater certainty that the Lord is working in your life, a more secure trust, a deeper dependence on God alone, that's what we're after this summer. That's what I'm praying for each one of us. So let's pray now. Father, we are grateful for the faith that you have given us. We recognize that it truly is a gift from you, that we can't manufacture it, but we thank you that you grant it to us. So God, would you stir up our faith in a deeper way today? Would you give us greater faith? We thank you for the promise of Jesus that says, if we even have faith like a mustard seed, we can do great things. God, we pray that you would grow our faith into a giant tree that's rooted in Jesus Christ. We pray this in his name. Amen. I want to have the kind of faith that says, I will do whatever it takes for Jesus Christ. I'm trusting him with all of the elements of my life, and I will do whatever it takes. The kind of faith that rushes to Jesus in the mountains and rushes to Jesus in the valleys. The kind of faith that is relentless for Jesus Christ, and I want that for you too. First, relentless faith takes action. Relentless faith takes action. We're here in Mark 2, beginning in verse 1. I'm going to read the first three verses here. And when Jesus returned to Capernaum after some days, it was reported that he was at home. And many were gathered together so that there was no more room, not even at the door. And he was preaching the word to them. And they came, bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. So this is the setup here. Have you ever been on the red line at rush hour in the morning? a couple people over here have. Now, I don't know if anybody's been to Tokyo. We had this little clip of like what the trains look like in rush hour on Tokyo. They actually have a job. These are people's job. They're called a train stuffer. It's actually their job. Their whole job is to get as many people as possible in the train. It's a little crazy to watch. I'm really glad that we don't have this on the Red Line, that it's just sort of like get, you know, cram on there. But it's crazy. There's all sorts of pictures of like people's faces, you know, stuffed up against the windows because they get every ounce of that train. I mean, it's, look at this. It's crazy. And people know this is coming and they still take the train. Would you be on the Red Line if it looked like that? I'm not sure that I would. This is what the house felt like where Jesus was. It was packed. It says there wasn't even room at the door. Just like the Red Line when it stops there, like at North and Clybourne's like the worst. When it opens there, no one moves and no one can get on. And you're just like, sorry, dude, you know. But that's what it's like at this house. So picture this. They're at this little house, okay. We'll talk a minute about the structure of the house. But it's like mud and thatched roof and all sorts of stuff like that. It's this little tiny house. And they're just packed in there because Jesus is there. And what's he doing there? He's preaching the word. That's what. Now, imagine what it was like to hear Jesus preach the word. Holy cow. Well, this house apparently was packed because people wanted to be there to hear Jesus talk about the word, to hear him teach. That's what's happening here. And then it says these four men, they're bringing this paralytic, this guy who is unable to walk. Now, we don't know why he was paralyzed, if he was paralyzed from birth or if it was like maybe a snowboarding accident or something like that. We don't actually know why the guy was paralyzed, but he was, and he was carried by these four men. Now picture a minute. So this guy lives his whole life laying on a mat. This is his whole life, is laying on this mat and asking people for money. And here what we see in this text is these four guys. Who are these guys? Were they friends? Were they just some dude on the road? I don't know. But apparently these four guys are carrying this paralytic. Now it says that they're bringing them to Jesus. Now what's crazy here is the paralytic has a willingness to be carried. I think for a lot of us, we're unable to see ourselves as someone in need. Some of us have ailments and things about our lives that are very easy for us to say, yeah, I got a problem here. But I think many of us have some things that we're dealing with that we're not willing to accept the fact that we need help, that I can't take care of this on my own. Some of us are so self-sufficient in this way that we don't recognize our needs. Some of us are like this paralytic man, plagued by a certain hurt or a certain sin or a pattern that you just can't break free from. You don't have the ability to fix the sin that has marked your life. We need people in our lives to take action and to bring us to Jesus Christ. But some of us are like the four friends here. They're carrying this guy, bringing him carried to Jesus by these four men. They're hurting people all around us. And you can't solve their problems. You walk past the person on the street who maybe appears to be in need, or the person on the street who appears to have everything that they would need. But they're hurting. They need to be brought to Jesus. Are we willing to do that? Or you can't fix their problems. You can't solve everything. Your bank account is not big enough to solve all of the problems in the city of Chicago. But you can walk over and grab a corner. There's four men here. There's a community around this guy trying to help him. And they can't fix it for him. But they know the one that can fix it. And they're willing to just pick up a corner and take him to Jesus. And for many of us, that's what we're called to do, is just to take someone to Jesus. There's a community here living this out. They don't see themselves as better than the guy laying on the mat. They don't see themselves as not needing of any help. But this guy here, we got to get him to Jesus. Now, people who were paralyzed in that day were seen as unclean. They were seen as like, you don't go near that person. There's actually some things where they were in that society, they had to like stand at a distance and yell unclean. Like, you're not, don't come around me because I'm ceremonially unclean. That's what they would see themselves at, and what the Pharisees would see them like. And so even for these men to be close enough to this guy, think about how clean was this bed that he's laying on his entire life. Like, they didn't have roads and sidewalks and things like that. He's laying on the dirt in the desert on a mat. And here are these four men who come there and pick up a corner, getting close to someone who many people, most people in their culture, would not want to be seen anywhere near. But they're getting very close to this guy, and they're picking up a corner, a dirty corner, to help this person because they see themselves as not any different. I too am in need of Jesus Christ. I may not have a physical mat that I'm carrying around, but I have a mat. What's the mat that you have? My failures, my past, my hurt, my patterns of sin that I can't break free from, the unforgiveness that I'm carrying around at all times that drives me to bitterness towards others. What's the mat that we're carrying? Whatever the mat that I'm carrying, Jesus can work power in my life, and he can have me changed forever, in an instant. But you have to get to Jesus. He alone has the power to do that. There's no steps in this process. Do these four guys even have a plan? I don't know. It just says they're carrying to Jesus, going to this house that's so packed they can't even get into the house. What in the world are they going to do? Do they have a plan? They just think, we just have to get him to Jesus. We've heard about this guy. We've heard the way that he preaches. We've heard the miracles that he does. We know that he has the power to heal, and we got to get this guy to Jesus, no matter what it takes. Relentless faith is singular in focus. Get him to Jesus. Here's a real quick list about the steps that they took, the active faith of these four. First, they saw someone in need. They saw the need of the person who was there. They didn't just walk past him and think somebody else will take care of that. They walked past him and thought, I can do something. There's a need there. They disrupted their plans. Where were they headed? What were they going to do that day? I don't know. Was their big plan to just be carrying this guy? I can't imagine it was light to carry somebody around and the trouble that they go through in just a minute that we'll see. But they disrupted their plans. And then third, as we've already said, they knew they just had to get him to Jesus. Whatever it takes, no matter what, we got to get him to Jesus. And then fourth, they put in the work. They actually did what they needed to do to get him to Jesus. I am so tired of, frankly, the world and Christians talking about all of these needs that we can meet and, oh, I'm stirred up in my heart, but then I don't do anything about it. Listen, biblical faith takes action. It doesn't mean anything if you don't take the action for it. We tell our kids all the time, they'll, you know, hit their sister or whatever, and we'll say, you know, say you're sorry, and they'll say, I'm sorry. And my wife came up with this line, it's brilliant. We say, what does sorry mean? And they know, my son's at the back, he would tell you, they know immediately, even my five-year-old knows this, sorry means don't do it again. Listen, it doesn't mean anything to just sort of, I feel sorry. I feel compassion about the people in the world who don't yet know Jesus Christ. I feel compassion about the people who are going to hell this week apart from Jesus Christ. That means nothing in your life if you don't take action. If you don't go to that person, open your mouth, and tell them about Jesus Christ. You don't have all the perfect words. You don't have all the verses memorized. You don't have all the answers to the difficult questions. It doesn't matter. Bring them to Jesus. Go to the person. Don't just feel compassion, but act on that. That is biblical Christianity. That is faith that acts on it, and that's what these men do. They put it to work, and even though they don't know the outcome, and even when I don't know the outcome, I know the one that controls the outcome, and that is enough to act. Relentless faith takes action, and secondly, relentless faith overcomes obstacles. Relentless faith overcomes obstacles. Verse 4 says, and when they could not get near him because of the crowd. Remember the train video we just saw? That's what it looked like. They couldn't get anywhere near him. When they could not get near him because of the crowd, they gave up and went home. Well, that's not what my version says. If you have that version, you should get rid of that Bible and get a new one. And it says, and when they could not get near him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him, above Jesus, and when they had made an opening, they let down the bed on which the paralytic lay. This is crazy. So what would have happened if these four men would have just given up? Nothing. The guy would still be paralyzed. He wouldn't have received anything that he needed. He wouldn't be, we'll see in a minute, he wouldn't be forgiven of his sins. They took him to Jesus, but if they hadn't taken the step to overcome some of the difficult obstacles, they didn't come to the front door and be like, I guess we'll get the next train. They didn't come to the door and say like, well, I guess it's not God's will for my friend to be saved because I just don't know how that's going to happen. I guess the Lord's not working there. I mean, I don't know. It's a little too tough. They didn't do that. They stepped through. They pressed past the difficulties that they had. So I need four guys. How about four of you guys? Come on up here. Come on. I'm not going to make you carry anyone, but just grab a corner. Thanks, guys. You sit in the front row. You're in the sermon. Okay. So these guys are carrying this thing. Now, I want you to just walk down these. This is two steps. Walk down the steps with the mat. Okay? And then come on back up. There you go. See, I'm just making them do this. Now, that wasn't too difficult because you don't have anybody laying there. But can you imagine if, like, especially you, what's your name?
Dan.
Especially if Dan is laying there. Dan is a little bit bigger than I am, you know. Even just this two steps would be kind of difficult to carry a guy. Because back then, these mats, these beds that they had, they were pretty similar to what like a thicker sleeping bag would be for us. They sometimes were stuffed with animals, like wool or things like that, sometimes with hay. But essentially, it was like a flexible mat. And so these guys are carrying him. Now, this is crazy, because it says that they removed the roof. Where would they have had to be to remove the roof? On the roof. So you guys got up two steps. Great job. Imagine doing that. Most of these homes had like a ladder on the back so that you could get up and repair the roof if there was a problem or things like that. Some of them in the wealthy homes had an actual staircase, but most of them, you were talking ladder. So four guys carrying a guy on a flexible mat to get him onto the roof. Thanks, guys. You can sit down. We're not going to make you carry Dan. Yeah, well done. Well done. So they get up on top of the roof with this guy. This is not an easy undertaking to get this guy up there. But they get on top. Luke 5 has this a similar account, has the same account in, and they tell a little more about the type of roof. It says that they had removed the tiles, which lets us know a little bit. Archaeology tells us these types of homes, what they would do is they would lay big beams across the roof and big beams of wood. And then over top of that, they would lay sticks, like thicker sticks. Think about when you're building a campfire. You start with the big logs, and then you get like a little bit smaller and smaller and smaller. So there's like, then it's essentially like a thatch roof with all of these sticks across there. And then on top of that, they would lay these clay tiles. They were like baked clay, big tiles that they would lay there. So they're real thick, you know, but they would be supported by these beams. And then on top of that, they would put a coating of mud on top of the tiles. And that mud, when the sun would shine, it would harden the mud. So it would produce like a clay. Now, most of these homes, you needed to redo the roof a lot quicker than you redo like our shingled roofs. It's a pretty permanent thing, you know. You had to like take off this mud eventually and redo it and that kind of thing. So what they're actually doing, it says that they're digging through, they're removing the tiles. It literally means they dig through. So picture this. There's these four guys. They carry this guy up on top of the roof, set him down, and then get down on their hands and knees, and they're digging through this caked, hard mud in the Palestinian sun. It's just baked on there. So like digging through this. Did they have a shovel? Probably not. I don't know. Digging through this, removing the tiles. And then so it says that they let him down above Jesus. So what they probably did is then the beams would stay and they would lower him. I don't know, ropes or something? The text doesn't tell us. But they would lower him in between the beams. So this kind of thing, they're not like destroying the entire house. It can be fixed. But it is like again, I have kids, and sometimes they, like, make a mess, and you're like, really? I'm going to have to clean that now? It's just, our shower was leaking the other day, and it's like, we don't have to tear the whole house down, but come on, now I got to go fix that. So that's like whoever owns this house. It says that Jesus was at home. I think that's the area. I don't think it's actually his house, but whoever's house this is, like, they're tearing a hole in the roof of some guy's house. So can you imagine? Some of us are better about this than others. Can you imagine some dude? He's like crammed in the corner, like, all right, I heard about this Jesus guy, and I'm really glad he's in my house, but I can't even move my arms. And then there's guys tearing a hole in the roof of my, what am I going to do to fix that, But these guys, they overcome the obstacles. They're willing to do whatever it takes. They did all of this work with no assurance of what would happen to their friend. But they were willing to overcome whatever obstacles stood in their way to see Jesus work. Are you willing to? When it gets difficult or takes longer than you thought, are you willing to overcome those obstacles in your life so that you can get to Jesus? Or do we let those things stand in our way? Here's four obstacles to relentless faith. Frustration. This is just, it's harder than I thought. This life and all the stressors that I have, it's so much harder than I thought it would be. People told me that following Jesus wasn't easy, but I didn't know it would be like this. I didn't know I would still be dealing with this stress, and I didn't know all of these things. It's harder than I thought. It's like the men, if they stopped at the door, it's too crowded. We don't know how we're going to get them up on the roof, and then once we get there, how are we going to get rid of all the stuff and get them down there? How are we even going to do this? It's just too hard. And then we give up. Obstacles to faith, frustration, time. It's just taking longer than I thought. Listen, I've been taking this pattern of sin to the Lord in prayer, and it's not gone yet. I've been praying for this person to come to Jesus Christ, and they're not there yet. And we start feeling like, is it ever going to happen? Are we ever going to be able to dig through this mud and remove these tiles and move the sticks? And then it's just taking way too much time. And then fear. What if it doesn't happen like I think it's going to happen? What if the thing that I'm praying for happens, but not like I meant for it to happen? Two years ago, I was praying for more opportunities to preach God's word. And I'm grateful for that answer to prayer. I wouldn't have prayed for it to happen in the way that it's happened. But I'm grateful for the Lord working because I know that his will is perfect and his plan is secure. But do we fear that it might not look like I wanted it to look, like I thought it would look? And we had this image that when we got to the house, there would be room and we would just kind of squeeze past some people and bring the guy to Jesus and it would be done. But it doesn't look like what I thought. And then fourthly, uncertainty. I just wrote, I don't even have a thought. Have you ever been in such a dark place that you're like, you get down on your knees to pray and you're like, I don't know what to say, Lord. Times like that, I pray, Lord, will you make a way where I can't see a way? Will you give me a path where there isn't a path? God, will you chop down the brush in front of me and clear a path through the wilderness for me? I don't know what that path is. I can't see that path. I don't know. But you know. And sometimes these obstacles, this frustration of time and of fear and of certainty, sometimes these things allow us to just be stuck in our tracks. And we don't take those steps of faith to push through the obstacles, to push harder when it gets more difficult, to go fast after Jesus when it seems the darkest. If the result is valuable enough to us, I'll do whatever it takes. If the result in your career is valuable enough, you'll do what it takes. If the result in your family is valuable enough to you, you will do what it takes. If the result in your walk with the Lord is valuable enough to you, you will do whatever it takes to get to Jesus. Bring them to Jesus. They don't need your arguments. They don't need your judgment. They don't even need your morality. They need Jesus. The people in our lives, so often we get into this like, why are you paralyzed? And what's wrong with you? And why can't you just get up and walk if you fix these other things? No, get him to Jesus. They don't need you to tell them what's wrong with them. They don't need you to tell them why they're on the floor. And if you were only this, then you wouldn't be. Get them to Jesus. His grace is sufficient. Now, yes, an understanding of our patterns of sin, but Scripture says his kindness leads us to repentance. I'm not for a moment suggesting that we overlook the sin in the people's lives around us. Jesus will take care of that. Get them the gospel. Get them the love of Christ that is found in a Savior that has paid for every sin that they have ever committed and everyone you have ever committed, and can cleanse them from all unrighteousness. Get them to Jesus, overcoming the obstacles. My faith, my relentless faith, will overcome the obstacles in my life. And lastly, relentless faith experiences God's power. Relentless faith experiences God's power. Now, it says in, I'm going to read the rest of this passage, which is 5 through 12, so bear with me a little bit. And it says in verse 5, and when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven. Now, some of the scribes that were sitting there questioned in their hearts, why does this man speak like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone? And immediately Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they had thus questioned within themselves, said to them, why do you question these things in your hearts? Which is easier to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise, take up your bed and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, rise, pick up your bed and go home. And he rose and immediately picked up his bed and went out before them all, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, we never saw anything like this. That's right, you haven't. It's interesting, he says in verse 5, when Jesus saw their faith, he says to the paralytic, most likely, I think the way that the grammar is structured here, I think what the author is really telling us is when Jesus saw the faith of all five. I think some people would say, you know, he's probably just talking about the four, but I really think the way that the grammar is structured, it seems to point to all five of them, that their faith together, he sees their collective faith. This is really encouraging to me. How many times have you been in your life and you feel like, I don't have it right now? I can't tell you how many times I've stepped into my small group and I've been like, I'm just a wreck. But the faith of the guys around me, praying for me, it's sort of like, lean on my faith when yours is lacking in some ways. And I think that what we have here is this beautiful picture of community helping a single person. And so that when we feel weak in faith, we can lean on the faith of others. When Jesus sees their faith, then he says to the paralytic, now what's crazy is like, tear the roof off, lower the guy. What was Jesus doing in here again? He's preaching. So like, I'm in the middle of my sermon and a hole comes in the roof right above me and some guy, now that would be a little bit distracting, I would think. They totally interrupted Jesus, the best preacher ever. Is this weird to anyone else? I was like, you didn't like, hey, Jesus, whenever you're done, we got a guy, we just loved it. We'll, afterwards, we'll talk with you afterwards. But they don't do that. They're just like, get him to Jesus right now, let's go. And they tear, they just, what's beautiful to me is what we see from Jesus is no rebuke, no, wait a minute, hold on, let me finish my third point here. None of that. Just forgiveness. Immediately, when he saw their faith, he gave forgiveness. It's beautiful too. Jesus goes right to the spiritual before he goes to the physical. He sees the guy's deeper need of forgiveness of sins. What happened to the friends? So they go through all these obstacles. You guys are up here on the roof and you lower him through. And you're like, we got him to Jesus. It's going to be, your sins are forgiven. That's not why we brought him here. How are we going to get him out now? Were they disappointed at first? This isn't why we went through all the trouble of carrying up onto the roof and tearing all these things down. But often when Jesus meets our deepest needs, it doesn't look like what we thought it would look like. We think that we need finances, but God gives us contentment. We think that we need relief, but God gives us strength. We think that we need healing, but God gives us comfort. We think that we need the physical, but God gives us the spiritual. Listen, relentless faith is always rewarded, but not always in the way that you think. God is always working and rushing to the person of faith. Our prayers are answered, not always in the way that we would ask for or the ways that we would look to, but in God's perfect sovereignty. But then the scribes and the Pharisees here, they're like immediately jumping right in with their contrarian nature, of course. They're questioning, why does this man speak like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone? Correct. Way to go, guys. You got something right for once. But that's what they go to. What is this guy saying? He can't do that. They completely missed the fact that Jesus was God. And he was about to show them that he was. But then he does this little thing. He says, why do you question these things? What's easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise, take up your bed and walk? Now, Jesus doesn't ask for an answer to that question, but what's easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or rise, take up your bed and walk? Yeah, your sins are forgiven. How is anyone else in the room going to know? Like, all right, fine, the sins are forgiven. Okay, no one can see that but the Lord. But definitely his sins are forgiven. That's the easier question to say. But there's no proof to that. So then Jesus proves his authority. Later we see that they never saw anything like this. Jesus shows his authority by not only forgiving his sins, but also performing this miracle. Sometimes God changes your circumstances to prove that he's changed your destination. And he does this for the paralytic. Now that's sometimes. He proves to the people around him. Sometimes God acts in the spiritual so significantly that we feel like we don't need the physical anymore. And we would say, like Paul says, my grace is sufficient for you. We receive God's grace. And even though I have this thorn in the flesh, even though I have this piece of my life that I feel like I can't live with, God gives me the grace for that. But here, he doesn't do that. He does heal the person to prove, to show that he is in control and he has the authority on earth to forgive sins. Now this man is told to get up, pick up his bed, and go home. The final act of faith in the man was to actually get up. Now, what was going through his mind? He's laying on the ground on his mat, and Jesus says, get up. I don't know that I can. What was going through his mind? But he gets up, he picks up his bed, and apparently goes home. Think of him there, getting up, picking up his bed. This is crazy. I can move. I can walk. Bed under his arm. Excuse me, guys. Excuse me. Excuse me. Excuse me, guys. Excuse me. Excuse me. Excuse me, excuse me, excuse me, through all the guys. While they're just standing there like. Can you see it? This man who potentially has never stood before in his entire life. The sunlight beaming through the hole in the roof where the faithful friends had just dropped him through. Was he dancing, bumping into the people who were there on that crowded house? This massive crowd standing there with their eyes open, their mouth open, their jaw to the floor, astonished at this miracle they have just witnessed. But I thought of one more thing when I was reading this. What did he, it's not in the text, this is just me thinking, what did he do with the bed? When he got home, he carries it home. Jesus says, take it home. What did he do with it? Did he put it on the wall as a reminder of Jesus's act for him? Did he burn it in celebration? I don't ever need that before. Did he hang it out front like a flag for everyone to see? I can tell you one thing. He didn't need it anymore. He didn't need the mat out in the square. So I'm not sure what he did with it, but whatever he did with it, we know that he no longer had use for it. What is it in your life that you feel like is your piece of identity? That this goes with me everywhere I am, everywhere I turn. That sin that seems to always be with you. The pattern of thinking and acting that seems so much a part of who you are that you just can't seem to get rid of it. But in Jesus' authority, you can pick it up and carry it away. You can discard it. You don't need to be known by that anymore. You don't need to be known by your sin that so easily entangles, because you have been changed by Jesus Christ. You are forgiven. You are healed. You are set free in Jesus Christ. And we don't need to be known by those things. Only Jesus forgives. Only Jesus mends what is broken. Only Jesus heals. And only Jesus has the authority over our lives to call out and with a word take that from you. We each desperately need Jesus Christ to call out to us and say, rise, take up your bed, and go home, because I've changed you. Your sins are forgiven. He can do this for you today. Let's pray. Father, we're amazed by your incredible grace for us, the forgiveness that you have given us in Jesus Christ. We recognize that we are like that paralytic, unable to walk, unable to do anything to affect our situation. But God, the small amount of faith that we have tells us to come to you, Jesus. We thank you for your grace that's sufficient as we go through the trials of our lives, that in the mountains and in the valleys that you're there with us, that we can be secure, that our feet are upon you, Lord. And we thank you for the fact that you wash us clean of all of our sins, that we're forgiven, that we're set free, that we no longer have to be held dominion of these things. We don't even have to be identified by them. That is not who we are. We are blood-bought sons of Jesus Christ. We're blood-bought daughters of the living King, and we're grateful for the fact that you have redeemed us and called us to yourself. You've called us to go from where we have been changed by you and to go to change others through the word of Jesus Christ. God, we thank you for the work in our lives that you've already accomplished, and we thank you for the work that you're yet to accomplish. Would we remember the way that you've changed us, so that when we're in those dark places, when we're in those valleys, we would look back to those mountaintops, the times that you have told us to rise and to take our bed and to walk, that we could celebrate those things. As we walk back into our homes, may we see that mat hung on the wall as a trophy of your grace in our life, Lord. That we have been changed because we have brought the smallest amount of faith to you, that you have stirred it up and encouraged us and challenged us and changed us because of your perfect love. May we carry that gospel. May we carry that message of simple mustard seed faith to the world that desperately needs you. Because only Jesus can save us. Give us this relentless faith that's found only in you. For your glory, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.